Hello everyone. In today's video, I shall be talking on Aristotle's theory of mimesis. My name is Navarun Ghosh. I am working as an assistant professor in the Department of English, Jagjivan College, Veer Kunwar Singh University, Ara. Aristotle was born in 384 BC and he died in 322 BC. He was born at Stagira in Chalcedice, and in 367 BC he was admitted to Plato's Academy in Athens. Friends, you might be remembering that in my previous video I have talked about Plato, and I have also mentioned that Plato had founded one institution called Academy, where he discussed with his fellow scholars the topics such as mathematics, philosophy and other subjects. And Aristotle was admitted to that academy. So Aristotle was a disciple of Plato, and Aristotle remained there as a student till the death of his master in 347 BC. So almost 20 years he was a student of Plato, and in 342 BC he was appointed as tutor to Alexander. Here Alexander means Alexander the great king of Greece. So he was the Aristotle was the teacher of Alexander, and in 335 he founded his famous school Lyceum, and he devoted himself to oral teaching on various subjects in that school. So for 7 years he was the tutor of Alexander, and after the death of Alexander's father he left the post and he founded the school, and he devoted himself to oral teaching on various subjects. He wrote many books during 342 to 335 BC, but most of his books are fragmentary because he has raised some questions which he did not answer in his several books. Or it may also be possible that he wrote the books completely, but the books are lost and it is not available to us. However, we can say that all the books and the concepts are not available to us in today. And his important books are Physics, Metaphysics, Nicomachean Ethics, Politics, On the Soul, and Poetics. The last book, Poetics, is the matter of concern for the students of literature, and in this video I shall be talking about some ideas and particularly mimesis from the book Poetics. The Poetics is sometimes mentioned as the earliest surviving work on literary theory. Sometimes because Plato also wrote about Poetics and poetic theory, but he did not dedicate himself to literary theory only. But Aristotle's Poetics is dedicated to literary theory only. That is why it is mentioned as the earliest surviving work on literary theory. It is a fragmentary work, as it has already been mentioned, but it consists 26 chapters, and it contains several unanswered questions which he himself raised in that book. And critics say that it is not only the first philosophical discussion of literature, but the foundation of all subsequent discussion. Yes, this is true, because all the subsequent discussions on literary theory are based on Aristotle's Poetics. And Aristotle gives a reply to Plato's charges against poets. You might be remembering that Plato charged the poets that they are useless things in an ideal society, and they should be banned from an ideal society. And being a disciple of Plato, Aristotle took the responsibility to answer that charge against poetry. To give a quick recap of Plato's criticism of poetry, let me discuss what Plato talked about poetry and poets in his book The Republic. Plato said that poets are ideal singer of an empty day. That means that poets are useless things. They don't have any contribution to do to the society, and poetry is an imitation of an imitation, or the poets are twice poets, or poetry or the art in general is twice removed from reality. According to Plato, first comes the idea, second comes the concrete object as per the idea, and then comes the work of art, which is an imitation of the concrete object. And poetry enchants rather than molds the character of the individual and the state. According to Plato, poetry or poet's task is to charm the readers and thereby influencing the readers instead of molding the character. And poetry deals with the baser aspects of human nature. As per Plato, poetry most of the time deals with the bad things of human nature instead of good things. And there is no poetic justice in poetry. It is often seen in poetry or in general literature, it is often seen that virtuous characters are punished instead of the villains. Villains get rewarded for their criminal activities, and virtuous characters or good persons are often get punished. So there is no poetic justice in poetry, according to Plato. And poetry is not a safe guide as it appeals to emotions rather than reason. Yes, this is true, because poetry deals with emotions and feelings instead of reason, which is a scientific faculty. And the place of a poet is between a prophet and a madman. So poets cannot be taken as a role model, because he or she is neither a prophet nor a madman. He is an in-between person. And dramatic poetry arouses baser instincts among the spectators instead of noble instincts. According to Plato, dramatic poetry increases the baser instinct. Baser instincts are bad instincts which easily influence the spectators instead of good instincts. So criminal activities or crimes can influence the spectators to do such activities in real life. And drama demoralizes the actors themselves. Those characters and the persons who play the role of villains repeatedly, one drama after another, they become villainous somewhat in their character. So these are the charges made by Plato against poetry, and that's why he banned poets from his ideal state in the Republic. Now comes Aristotle's mimesis or imitation. Critics like J.W.H. Atkins and Lascelles Abercrombie think that poetics was written as a reply to Plato's scathing criticism against poetry. It is true, because Aristotle was a student of Plato, and he himself knew the concepts and the reasons why Plato banned the poets from his ideal state. And in chapter 4 of Poetics, Aristotle says imitation is a fundamental human instinct. According to Aristotle, imitation is a basic human nature. See, for example, a small child starts imitating his near and dear ones, and thereby he learns language, thereby he learns how to walk, how to run, how to eat. Everything he learns by imitation. That's why Aristotle says imitation is a fundamental human instinct. And poetry is an imitation of action. This imitation is lodged into organic structure of plot of poetry. So poetry is an imitation of action. Action of what? Action which is to be found in plot. Plot here does not mean that it is a sequence of events. It is an organic structure which is created by the imagination of a poet. And poetry for Aristotle is not a mere copy of ordinary events, but a generator of idealized rendering of character in action. So poetry, unlike others, it does not copy something which is available in the society. A poet does not see a man of action and describe the action in his poetry. He rather idealizes a man, idealizes that man's action, and he describes that action in words in literature. So poet does not copy whatever is happening in front of him. He rather creates that reality in his mind through imagination and describes it. Artistic imagination or artistic imitation is an act of aesthetic creation. That's why artistic imitation is an act of aesthetic creation. As I have already explained, that poetry is something which is created in the mind of a poet. Poet first creates a situation, he creates a character, he creates an action, and then he describes it. He does not see the action in front of him and copies it. So it is an aesthetic creation. Aristotle's reply to Plato. So these are the replies. Aristotle's artist does not imitate the concrete object. So going by the same logic of idea and the table and painting and other forms of art, Aristotle thinks that poetry does not copy the imitation of an imitation, that is the table which belongs to the idea. Rather, Aristotle thinks that poet imitates the universal form and thereby giving it a more complete expression which is only half revealed in the world of reality. So first there is idea and there are concrete objects which is based upon that idea. But poets do not copy the objects, concrete objects which is available, which are available in the world of reality, but he tries to create some idea which is universal, which has to be found throughout the world. That's how, according to Aristotle, poet is a creator instead of an imitator. An artist imitates because he gets pleasure in imitation. This is one important point, because according to Aristotle, when he says that artist gets pleasure out of imitation, he is somewhat supporting the later movement which came lately in British literature, which is known as art for art's sake. According to Plato, if a poet gets pleasure by imitating something, that means he is supporting art for art's sake. While Plato thinks art has something else to do, an artist has to contribute for the betterment of a society. Plato believed that art should be for the sake of morality instead of for the sake of art or pleasure only. And all art is imitation, but they are of different kinds. Now, after replying to Plato's charges, Aristotle goes on to differentiate between different kinds of art, such as music, painting, literature. So according to Aristotle, there are three criteria by applying which different art forms can be distinguished. The three criteria are model of imitation, medium of imitation, and manner of imitation. Model is nothing but subject. So far as tragedies are concerned, epic and tragedy, they imitate man as better. While in comedy, man is imitated as worse. So in other words, in epic and tragedy, we find serious subjects, man in serious business. And in comedy, we find man as something playful or worse. The situation is not as serious as in epic and tragedy. So by applying the theory of model of imitation, we can differentiate between epic, tragedy and comedy. The next point is medium of imitation. And see, for example, in literature, the medium is word or language. And in painting, the medium is color or brush. So the medium is different in painting and literature. So that's how we can differentiate between painting and literature, by their medium of imitation. And the third one is manner of imitation. In manner of imitation, in literature, we see narration is the manner. By narrating some event, a work of art is presented in literature. And in dance, for example, rhythm is the manner. Now you can ask, what about singing and dance? In both, rhythm is used. So how to differentiate between them? In singing, rhythm as well as words, both are used. So it is a mixture of rhythm and words. And in dance, only rhythm is there. So by applying this theory, according to Aristotle, different forms of art can be differentiated. And human nature can be understood by their model of imitation. Now here Aristotle gives a psychological theory also. Remember friends that this is very old theory. Nowadays we can easily say that somebody who likes tragedy can be a sober character, and somebody who likes comedy can be a jolly character. But these things has been said by Aristotle as early as 350 BC. So this is important from the time's perspective. The next point is truth in poetry, history and philosophy. It is said by Aristotle that it is not the function of the poet to relate what has happened, but what may happen, what is possible according to the law of probability or necessity. Poetry, therefore, is a mere philosophical and higher thing than history. For poetry tends to express the universal, history the particular. Now see these lines, these are very important lines written by Aristotle himself. He thinks that poetry is something which deals with universality, and history is something which deals with particular things. So poetry, is more philosophical than history, because history tries to depict facts, but in poetry we can find fact and fiction and philosophy as well. History deals with particular persons, places or things. This is true because history deals with facts. Poetry is not circumscribed by geographical limitations, and it deals with truth of universal kind. Whereas history, say for example, Indian history will be talking about India. But it is not necessary that Indian poetry will be talking about only India. It can be applicable to other countries also, because it deals with emotions, and emotions are universal. It is not restricted or constrained to a particular geographical place. So history is not universal, but poetry is universal. History deals with facts as dry as dust, but the poet deals with inner human action. This is already mentioned. Poetry deals with inner human action. Inner human action is universal. Be a person from India or from America or from Europe, inner human action is same. But history will be different from place to place. A historian cannot invent facts, but a poet working on the law of probability or necessity can invent fictitious truth. History or a historian cannot invent facts, because he has to depict whatever has happened in front of him, whatever truth is available to him in front of him. But a poet can invent facts, because poet works on the law of probability or necessity. A poet applies imagination. A poetic work is fictitious, it is not factual. Therefore, a historian cannot invent facts, but a poet can. Now, philosophy endeavors to discover the universal in the particular, but poetry represents the universal through the particular. See the difference here. Philosophy also tries to deal with universal thing, but he tries to find universality in a particular thing. But poetry also deals with universality, but he or poet tries to represent universality through the particular. That means that philosophy is more theoretical. It can be learned, but poetry also deals with philosophy, and in poetry, philosophy can be experienced. See the difference? In philosophy can be learned, but philosophy in poetry can be experienced. So poetry makes it more interesting. To learn philosophy, one can take the help of poetry. And history is a mere depiction of fact. There is no philosophy in history. So it is a mere depiction of fact. Whatever has happened, it has been described. Both history and philosophy can be found in poetry with an additional dose of emotion. So we can find fact, we can find philosophy, both in poetry, with an additional dose of emotion, with an additional dose of feelings. So poetry is better than philosophy and history, because poetry encompasses both philosophy and history. But history cannot encompass poetry. Philosophy cannot encompass poetry. But poetry can encompass philosophy and history, both. So that's how poetry, according to Aristotle, is better than these two other fields of study. So here we come to the end of this video. I must mention that these notes, the notes of in this PPT are prepared from Principles and History of Literary Criticism. It is a book written by S.C. Mundra and S.C. Agarwal. It is a very good book. You also can take a note of the name of this book, and it will be definitely helpful to read this book. And thank you very much for listening to this video. And if you have any doubt, you can contact me in this email ID or in the comment box if you want to mention. Thank you very much.